We also hope to reach out to the unreached areas through the partnership with the civil society organizations, networks, and other collaborative partners who are present on the ground. It also envisages to bring a critical mass of men and boys who will lead the change in their respective local context. We also committed to use the resource materials and the knowledge that are already available and acknowledge the source and with the required permissions. The idea is not to duplicate, but to go deeper and build a climate of partnership for change by standing in solidarity with others and also initiate the actions where it is required. Friends, in that context, I would like to invite the panelists, especially Fatima Karan. She's going to moderate today the panel discussion. She's a lead anchor, and she has been a leading anchor and the producer since 2005. In the past, she worked with Bloomberg India TV, and currently she's the consulting editor at BTV and And Fatima anchors Launch Money and Market Rewind together with Women Mean Business. Her program, Women Mean Business, tries to fill every important gap that of course, the discourse around the women in business. And we hearty welcome for coming and agreeing to moderate the session. I would also like to quickly introduce the other panelists. Anshul Tiwari from Youth Awaaz, and he's the Ashoka Fellow and founder of Youth Awaaz, and one of the India's largest online platform working with young people. Welcome, sir. And Dr. Abhijeet, and Abhijeet is currently the director of Center for Health and Social Justice, and he's also very much partnered with the XR Network, and he's currently convener of the COPASHA, a global health rights and social accountability network, and co-chair of Men Engage Global Alliance, a network of organizations working with men and boys on gender equality. Welcome, Abhijeet. We also have Akanksha. She represents the YWCAs of India and Associate Secretary for the Youth Development. She's also a student, and she's also closely worked on the youth programs for advocacy and capacity building, and especially on the issues of gender trade. And we also have Annie Namala. She's the convener of the Vadanathoda Abhiyan. Also had 3 decades of experience of working at the grassroots and middle level, and also at the national and international level on issues of social exclusion and promoting equality and also strengthening the civil society at a global level. So with that, I'd like to hand over back to Fatima.
Thank you very much for having me here. First of all, happy Friday to everybody. I think this is a very dedicated lot of people who are sitting here on a Friday evening, and we're talking about something very important, which is gender equality, as well as the critical issue of masculinity. As you can see from my panel, there's absolutely an incredible amount of diversity that this panel brings to this discussion. The way I was just thinking we would do it is that we'd have a rolling conversation that's going to go on for about half an hour maximum. At some stage, it'd be wonderful to get some key stakeholders and voices in the audience to come in and ask us some questions. I believe some of our panelists may have to leave at that stage. So we're going to keep the discussion as tight as we can. When I was going over the invitation that was sent to me by the organization, I realized that one of the critical ideas that they have is the definition of masculinity. And there are at least 5 dimensions to that that have been spoken about. We'll get into that. But I'm just going to start this evening by asking my panelists, is masculinity, the way we know it, a damaging concept? And also, what does it really mean to you?
Thank you for that question. I think increasingly we are understanding more and more about masculinity. You know, we started with an understanding that masculinity and femininity are 2 binary sort of constructs in which characters like a man becomes masculinity and characters like a woman becomes femininity. But increasingly what we understand is masculinity, and we don't use the word masculinity anymore, we use the word masculinities, is that these are the social constructs or the social sort of compulsions of what it means to be a man. But that is not enough. The word masculinities has now been introduced because what we realize is that there are multiple pressures of being a man. And one of the important things about that is that this relationship of man is not only with women, which is usually the domain of gender relations, but men have relationships among each other. So the dangerous part is the fact that inherent in this masculinities is the strong idea of dominating over others. So even in relationships between men, there is a tendency to dominate. And that domination is done through various, so there could be caste domination, class domination, age-based domination, rural-urban domination. And this idea of domination, it's an idea. Even a person who's not in a position of domination aspires to dominate. And this is what we call hegemonic masculinity or dominating masculinity. And that is a power, that's a very negative idea because it creates destruction through the domination idea. What we have to work against is not masculinities. What we have to work against is the hegemonic masculinities and create what we call alternative masculinities, which believe in far more egalitarian relationships, far more peace, far more equity, far more sort of what we call solidarity. And it's not that this is not there. Historically, we have found people who espouse the non-dominant, the more alternative masculinity. For example, we would, the alternate traditions, the Bhakti traditions, the Sufi traditions, and they are people from, men from thousands of years, we remember them. It is because when the idea of an alternative, more peaceful, more egalitarian, more solidarity-based masculinity comes up, that idea can be extremely powerful.
Anshul, you are a founder and editor-in-chief of Youth Ki Awaaz. You really have your finger on the pulse in terms of the youth as well as existing traditions and also the kind of demographics you can talk to going forward. Look at what Dr. Das has said. He said that masculinity itself, the word is not a problem. The issue is hegemonic masculinity as well as the fact that people tend to forget that historically there have been many alternative ideas of masculinity. So how would you sort of react to that, given the fact that you are the Youth Ki Awaaz?
So I am not the Youth Ki Awaaz, but sure, thank you for that.
Had to say.
I agree with Dr. Das. And just to add on to it, I would like to say that, the way we are seeing masculinity play out in different aspects of our life, be it through popular culture, advertising, movies, and cinema, and so on, or be it even when we are growing up in school, on how men and women are treated very differently, and how different roles are assigned to them from the very start. It kind of shows how toxic this masculinity really is, and it impacts men very deeply. And I don't think that enough conversation happens around how deeply is patriarchy and masculinity really affecting men, because it is, at the end of the day, Dr. Das already said, it's a social construct that is kind of leading to a certain kind of an upbringing. It's leading to a certain kind of a culture around us. It's leading to a certain kind of a dialogue that happens. If you look at social media, for instance, just look at the amount of trolling that happens by men on women, where they are extremely proud of themselves for being men of a certain kind and so on. So I think, the impact really on young people is very evident. It's really out there. We need to have more dialogues, more publicly, and we need way more interventions, especially from the time when children are growing up, when they are actually entering schools. So that's, I think that's very crucial.
And I think one of the points you bring up is that we don't seem to talk enough about how these constructs affect men themselves, because there are a lot of pressures that they're dealing with itself. At this stage, I'm going to bring in Akanksha. You've, of course, had a lot of work with YWCA, and you've also worked across youth organizations. Interesting, in your profile, it says you've been part of sexual harassment committees for various organizations. When we're talking about this whole issue of masculinity and how it affects behaviors and the kind of pressures even men feel, just tell me a little bit more about how your work has intersected with those experiences.
Well, we had used to do advocacy initially, we had an interaction. We would go, initially we didn't know the pulse of the audience, the public. So what we did was we just went to the general public and we talked about women's violence, and we just wanted to know what they know. And a lot of them came back and said, okay, you have all these laws for women, what about us? But what they don't realize is it is not, the sexual harassment laws are not anti-men. But the way they're implemented, the way they're understood, and the way some people use it, okay. It's interpreted differently. I think that way also a lot of men feel that they're being attacked, whereas the whole idea is not gender equality does not mean attacking men or submissing men. It means inclusive growth.
Okay. All right, good points that you've put in there. Miss Annie Namala, can you please come in on what you have to say in terms of what you've heard about this whole issue of how we know masculinity and how it obviously affects people and their behaviors?
I'll make it Hindi, English.
थैंक यू मुझे थोड़ा लग रही है कि ये जो टर्म है मैस्कुलिनिटी वो एक यूनिफॉर्म टर्म भी नहीं है आज भी जब भी हम मैस्कुलिनिटीज़ कहते हैं फिर भी शायद एक यूनिफॉर्म टर्म नहीं है क्योंकि बहुत कंटेक्चुअलाइज्ड हैं अगर हम देखें एक दलित मेल को वो डोमिनेंट कम्युनिटी विमेन के साथ वो डोमिनेशन नहीं करते हैं तो वहाँ पर इट्स अ डिफरेंट रियालिटी नो और अ मार्जिनलाइज्ड मेल पर्सन और अ बॉय तो ये जो कॉन्टेक्चुअलिटी है वो ऑलरेडी एग्जिस्ट करती है और वो भी पावर के ऊपर हाउ मैस्कुलिनिटी सो इंटरलिंक विद पावर नो तो जहाँ पर मेन को भी थोड़ा कम पावर है तो मैस्कुलिनिटी वहाँ पर नहीं दिखाते जबकि वो इनहेरेंट है इन सम वेज पावर एज एन इनहेरेंट स्ट्रेंथ आई मीन लाइक नो पावर एज एन इनहेरेंट डिनोमिनेटर इज देयर तो मुझे लग रही है कि मैस्कुलिनिटी को थोड़ा कॉन्टेक्चुअल देखने की ज़रूरत है कि अलग अलग कैटेगरीज और सेक्शंस कैसे इसको यू नो एक्सरसाइज करते हैं और मुझे थोड़ा सा अल्टरनेट मैस्कुलिनिटीज उस वर्ड में मुझे थोड़ा प्रॉब्लम ही लग रही है क्योंकि जब तक हम जैसे डोमिन अपर कास्ट हम यूज़ करते हैं और लोअर कास्ट हम यूज़ करते हैं तो वो आप कैसे भी कहो वो अपर कास्ट ही रहती है तो आई थिंक व्हेन हम जब अल्टरनेट वर्ड्स के लिए हम जब ढूंढते हैं तो आई थिंक वी हैव टू रियली लुक फॉर एन completely alternate
okay
word.
But I don't want to get stuck on a word we're getting stuck on I want to talk about the larger problem here okay I completely understand what you're saying and you've talked about intersectionality and things like that but just before we do that I would like to bring in our panelist Raphael Jose he's joined us now thank you for coming in I understand that you are currently working with Superdra you're in charge of leading and managing the ethical trading mandate also other operations within the company going away from what Ms. Annie was saying, all of us were just trying to give the audience a sense of what we think is the problem with what masculinity is. Away from the fact that it is a word and there are other definitions, I think all of us are agreeing on one point, which is that there seems to be this whole idea of power and domination. And that seems to be the larger issue that eventually leads to a lot of problems when it comes to gender. As an organization, is there a way that organizations can teach cultures to avoid this problem?
Yeah, what I would say is that, you know, I'm a dad. I have two daughters.
Like
so
you.
So, and of course, I work for a fashion brand. You know, so we all I can see based on the experience that I personally have, and I also what I've, you know, learned over the years, there are two aspects to the whole the masculinity question. One is the acquired identity, which is passed on from culture, the patriarchy that exists, yeah. Or you know there are a lot of cultural elements. Because why I say this is because I belong to Kerala. I have also seen a lot of my friends belonging to a matrilineal community, where you know women are you know traditionally empowered. And there, this aspect, which you mentioned, the power equation, which is normally acquired in a patriarchal kind of family setup, a lot of these things are they're not there. So it's a proof very clearly that that's an acquired one. It's acquired through the cultural the foundations that we inherit. But there is another aspect of masculinity, which is actually, defined by nature, you know, the way we are wired. And I don't see a problem with that because traditionally man was a hunter-gatherer, you know, he had that role. And of course, the technology is disrupting that role in a big way, a lot of these things. But still, that role, made him, especially when his wife, his loved one is expecting, she has a different role of nurturer, and he being a gatherer, and you know these two roles basically they're harmonious. I mean, there is no conflict in that. In fact, they gel so well. And when we address this masculinity question, the men shouldn't be made to feel that they are losing identity. In fact, that particular role that is given by nature actually gives them so much of responsibility. Yeah, yeah. So it's like an irresponsible part. It's an irresponsible masculinity. My other colleague in this panel, he mentioned, he used the word, power, the masculinity that is very, very hegemonious. That has to do with more with, the setup, the politics, the power relations. And, that's the difference.
Just one point. I just feel that we cannot talk about nature primarily because according to the order of the nature, homosexuality is a crime. So if we go by that logic, I think a lot will have to be redefined. So I think that's an important point.
Dr. Das, you want to come in on this quickly?
I think in 2017, we should leave what we call biological essentialism and talk about social construction, because we are socially constructing everything. The problem or the solution both lie in understanding that what is our driving value system or driving social value system. And human beings are different from other animals because we create social value systems which guide our actions. We have to understand that the idea of equality, what I'm saying may sound a little theoretical, but I'm telling you everything that I say has been born out of practice. The idea of equality is a recent idea. So to expect that everybody will jump onto the equality bandwagon very easily is not easy. Even among women, if you see classically, there has been situations of control and domination. So the idea that men will not be dominant just because, we have decided of gender equality is not going to happen. So what we are talking of is reconstruction of power. The main way in which power was exercised in the past, or it was seen as the important way of exercising power, is power over. And power as a zero-sum game, as we see. If I take power, you lose power. But what we have understood, and this is mid to late 20th century work, and I have seen it in my own work, is this is not the only way of power. We have solidarity power, which has been exercised by all social movements, even feminist movements, class movements, have talked of solidarity power. The second thing is autonomy power, is the power of myself. Now, if you have equality as your driving value, and if you can change the social norm to equality being your driving value, then what you do is, instead of power over, the dominating power being the power which you exercise, you move towards more of solidarity power, which is equality built into it, and you use whatever power you have to share power. So you create your autonomy to make others autonomous. And okay. I think these are things that we have seen in our work in states of India, in extremely patriarchal, extremely hegemonic areas in Marathwada. We have seen it in Gwalior, Morena area, which is Bundelkhand. We are seeing it in Rajasthan. We are seeing it in Eastern UP. There are colleagues here from the PACS partnership who have been the people who have actually implemented projects in which you change people's perception of how power is exercised.
Okay, and I'm going to come back to you on that. Just bringing us to the next points, and this is where I'm going to ask Akanksha and also Ms. Sani to come in. We've just been talking about how, this whole idea is a social construct, and the good thing about that is that you can socially deconstruct it, right? And reconstruct it, right? It's like demonetization and remonetization. Anyway, just kidding. What I'm saying is, some of the big things that people talk about when it comes to perceived masculine attitudes and behaviors, which then lead to other problematic issues, are language. This is the wonderful list that's been given to me even by Fia. The concept of honor, how unfair that is, how a woman is supposed to be holding together the family's honor. Unfortunately, there seem to be no such ideas around, I guess, the male members. Division of labor at home, and this is what I'm going to come back to you, Raphael, in some stage in terms of the ideas of who should be at home and what they should be doing, and also parenting. Because, when it comes to this modern day and age, I think it's no longer just about, women are inferior to men and women should stay at home. I think a lot of us, thankfully, are educated enough, at least in urban working areas, and even in villages and other places, where, that is quite a, I think we're away from that. It's just that the kind of gender stereotyping, which is what this organization is trying to abolish, really comes into place when it comes to the everyday existence of people, of how women work, or how perhaps safe they feel at work, how men feel when they're treating the opposite gender, how they feel talking to their own gender, Now, Dr. Das talked about how he's had some very successful projects of change. Akanksha, you've worked across the spectrum. Give me a few examples of things you've really seen be efficient in terms of gender training.
Well, we had an, I'll just share an experience. Yeah. So what we would do is do small social experiments before we did our actual workshop. And we just wanted to know the men's perception on certain things. And we wanted to see whether women think differently about it. The funny thing is that when we had an interaction with the men, the things they do, the things they discuss in their own groups was quite similar to what girls used to actually do it. But what the we found out was the lack of communication between the two genders. So it is assumed a lot of times that, you know, men want to be doing those certain things
give
that
an
are
example.
Masculine. Give like supposing, like one of my friends, he told me that if a girl was passing by and his the alpha friend would comment on her, a whole group would feel compelled to say something about her. And that friend of mine told me that a lot of times I didn't feel like doing it, but because I wanted to be part of that group, I would say it. But I would feel bad inside. I wouldn't want to say it. Okay. And that's a genuine feeling. And he said, I would discuss it with my friends and we would just not talk about it because it was not manly enough. It was not considered that way. And when we spoke to women, they said that, oh, but we also comment on men. But we do it quite openly, and it's not shared between the two sexes. It was we found that out, and a lot of times men want to cook, but they are not allowed because, okay, somebody's watching them. Because they have to, if they feel that if they don't do that particular masculine thing, sure, they're not manly enough. They won't be considered part of the society.
As far as, you know, building a gender sensitivity, one of my experiences is that despite the fact that gender has been a public discussion debate for many, many years, it's surprising to see how little it has reached to many other corners. In the social sector, we always think that many people know about it. But if you really go into corporate sector or, you know, other government sector, there's hardly any kind of an understanding. So one thing I have realized is that it needs to be a mixed setting where people are able to really dialogue with each other on what are the issues, and it needs to include experiential patterns. It's just not telling them or theorizing them, but actually putting them on that spot of simulation, yeah, and then people are able to say, okay, you know, there is something that here needs to be reworked. So my experience has been mixed groups with simulation games and activities, which really create a kind of a sensitivity on these
And
things.
How can you expect me not to actually ask you to do a quick simulation on the person sitting right next to you? Here's a corporate voice, right? In all seriousness, I'm interested in what you're saying, because you're saying, look, it has to be experiential. Here you have a corporate voice, right? The gentleman is talking about how he thinks about gender. If you were to be given the opportunity to perhaps train more people at SuperDry to make the most out of their workforce, which is eventually really about understanding gender, right? What are some of the key pointers you would give a corporate?
See, one of the main areas would be stereotypes. Because we have a lot of stereotypes. Suppose I ask you, manager, what will you say? Give me a name for a manager.
Nobody's going to judge anything you say. I'm not picking on you. Trust me, I'm going to go to the professor as well.
I report
and
to
then I'll talk to you about media.
My manager is a lady, by the way.
Excellent. Oh, that's very nice.
I've always worked under lady managers. Yeah. Yeah. So I don't have a... I've been slightly misunderstood here. What I was basically impinging upon is that certain roles have to be given the same status instead of man wanting to do women's thing, or
sure,
women wanting to do men's thing, is the empowerment of women's role. So we have a problem in the current construct is that a housewife is not somebody who's at par with the working man. Therein lies the problem. Because...
He's bringing two different points here.
Let me complete.
Yeah.
Now, there are situations where I have a lot of friends who are actually house husbands. Yeah, and their wives are working. It's a choice that they made. It's a choice that the couple made. But we are not, I'm not implying that these are stereotype roles.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is the roles need to be empowered. The stereotype isn't the construct itself. Is that The rights are only for the working
man. The person who's staying at home for some reason is being made to look as if they're not doing as much as, say, the person who's in the...
So what? A very simple question I would ask, and not only to you, but why do we only give maternity leave?
Now, no, I agree with you.
Because
there should
that's
be paternity
a very,
leave.
Very, very simple.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, you know, but I think as long as you do not...
paternity is being increasingly recognized in the corporate world.
Sure.
And I think it's, if you look at the Scandinavian countries...
Agree.
Is really
Europe
growing.
Is.
No, they are setting the... So
not the US, but Europe is.
No, no, I think, Dr. Das, just one second. Can I just come in on this?
Yeah, even... But as long as you do not monetize housework, you do not add an economic value to it, it will continue to be devalued.
The problem is it's too much of an intimate relationship, right? I mean,
no,
you're not
going
to be paying your housework. How you monetize it.
No, yeah. You will need to sort of monetize within the GDP the contribution that women are making to the GDP, because it's not just that that is not productive.
Yeah. Okay.
It is
and
productive
also,
in many ways. Yeah, but as long as you don't do it, then it will still continue to be a devalued job.
Yes, I want to add, sorry. It's not the housework per se. It's also the quality of what value the woman contributes. I mean, my kids are literally brought up by, you know, my wife. Yeah, in the sense that because I have a traveling job, intense, I stay away from the family. Now, the value that she, you know, she's adding is to my, I mean, to my kids is immense, that I'm not adding that value. So literally, if you look at the way my finances are managed at home, everything is managed by her, and she makes the decisions also.
Okay.
So she had a very successful corporate career. When we met, we were dating, we were, you know, married, and we were, I mean, she was working for many years until the kids were born, and then she made a conscious decision based on the agreement that we have. So it's not that she's less powerful than I am. It's just the roles have changed. I'm the hunter-gatherer, but she is equally powerful.
Okay, one second. We're going to stop talking about this, because I think what's becoming clear is, again, we're trying to understand where these ideas of inequality kind of stem from. Anshul, you've been watching very carefully, and this is like all good editors do, you know, you just look around and see what everybody's seeing. But I want you to just tell me a little bit about, we've talked about the existing issues, perhaps one of them is how you value certain roles. It appears to me that more and more, the larger issue when we're talking about gender or whatever it is actually a lot of lack of communication about men, so to speak, the male gender, perhaps issues that exist within that, the pressures that exist within that. How can platforms like yours, how do platforms like yours work to reach, to change these constructs that exist?
Right. So, you know, for our platform in particular, gender is a very important subject. Pretty much every third story on the platform is a gender-related story. And we have also taken it up as a mandate to talk about patriarchy and the constructs that it creates in the society. So, you know, over the last 5 years or so of running constant campaigns around gender and masculinity, we've seen that, you know, there is a lot of resistance you face from a lot of young people online, but you also have the right opportunities to intervene, you know, using the right kind of content. We've been able to use stories of young men who've been able to deconstruct masculinity and have been able to really challenge patriarchal norms themselves, who've been able to identify themselves as feminists, who've been able to really understand what their role and what their privilege of being a man really means. Okay. Because that, I think, is something that nobody talks about, just the privilege of being a man in the society, right? So I think the key role that platforms, not just like Youth Kiawas, but pretty much everybody else, you know, in the media has, is to create more content, to make this an important agenda and not treat this as a soft story, not treat this as something that, you know, will not be read or will not be consumed.
You bring up a lovely point, which is the soft story, right? I mean, I've seen gender bias within editorial beats, okay? For example, oh, you're a girl, you can cover this. Not that it exists in business, by the way. Business, which is where I work for now, very, very, it doesn't matter. You know the steel sector, you cover the steel sector. You know, you're into PSUs, go for it. I don't think it was always that way in general news. But good point that you're making about soft stories and adding value. But let's look at it away from the whole ethical, you know, I'm a good human being and, you know, let's all be equal kind of thing. Let's become hard-nosed business people about this. I've been going through lots of reports about the benefit, the value, the dollar value of gender equality at work, right? So whether it's an Ernst & Young or a KPMG or whatever it is, these are organizations that are working to tell you why organizations benefit when they hold on to good workers. The good thing about good workers is that they can be male or female. That seems to be a very efficient message, right? Because that will help an organization, you know, whether it comes to paternity leave, maternity leave, you know, perhaps teaching people how to expand networks. Let's add value to this whole thing. So tell me, Akanksha, if I was trying to ask you to give me a hard-nosed value proposition of gender equality, what are some of the arguments you'd make? Why should it make sense for me as a business or an organization to teach my employees about gender equality?
I think anybody, irrespective of businesses, needs to know about gender equality and not. And a lot of times we assume that only the educated people know. Possibly they know it as a word, but a lot of people, other than they may not be educated, but they'll know the whole idea of it. And I think it's a perception more than anything else. So I think it's important that they have this equality so that you take out the best out of your employees. You get the best potential. You're after all looking at the best profits, the best progress for your own business. So why would you leave out the potential candidate who's going to take your profit forward or your business forward?
You want to say something?
Yeah, I think we have to make a distinction between good business and exploitative business. So I'm leaving exploitative business out. So efficiency at the cost of child labor, efficiency at the cost of, you know, I'm assuming that that's not.
No,
what
I'm assuming. Yeah,
about.
That's completely out of the discussion.
Ethics is there. So even in business, there is an ethical standard. So now, what I'm wondering, sir, how many women? The example that our friend just said is there was his wife dropped out from the workforce. She was an excellent corporate or whatever productive person. She dropped out of the workforce. How many women are dropping out of the workforce because they have to do homemaking? For them, it becomes an option to do either homemaking or profession.
That's because the organizations are usually not stepping up.
So one issue is that when you lose trained, so you're basically losing a trained resource at a certain point when they're actually going to take off in their professional sphere from being mid-manager to senior management, they're getting into the child care trap.
Yeah.
So that's number one. Number two is women, when they get back, even if they get back, they've lost something because there's this thing that, oh, they were not there for so many years. But it's never talked of with men. If childcare responsibilities is made bilateral, then women are not losing out professionally from their own professional growth. So these are two small things. What we've seen at the family level is that you can do both your childcare responsibilities and you can do both your economic activity better if there is an issue of partnership and not, you know, what is happening, and many of my friends will bear with me here, is that as we put more women into the economic domain, men are not getting economic work. So what is happening is, and Bangladesh is probably a classic example, is women becoming economic producers and men are now on the streets because there is no employment for them. So the question is, not to replace one labor force with another labor force. The question is, how can you make both genders part of the productive labor force without one having to necessarily drop out because of compulsions? And the moment they drop out, let us say women drop out and men continue, there's a problem. The other is, if like in Bangladesh, women are in the labor force and men are not in the labor force, you create a social antipathy against gender. And that actually leads higher gender violence, because men who have not been trained in any way to not be the hunter-gatherer, the provider, are now seeing themselves completely lost. That is another crisis of masculinity that we are seeing.
Yeah, but that, once again, we're going back to the
issue. So the question is, it is not an either-or situation. Men can, the raising up of what we do to our children, and including all of us here, is what is the aspiration that we are creating in women? And what is the aspiration we are creating in boys? We are creating different aspirations in our children. The question is, we have to raise our children differently.
And different, you know, on a very superficial level, I think everybody must have read about this. There's a huge toy store called Toys R Us in the States, right? And they started doing, by the way, I was one of those girls who played with Hot Wheels when I was, I mean, my mother gave me a few Barbies. I cut their hair, I painted them purple. It wasn't because I was trying to be a guy, but that's what came naturally to me. But in all seriousness, Toys R Us has started doing these shelves that are not about boys and girls and the pinks and purples and all that. So I think what you're talking about is that whole, how do you raise the kids? Miss Annie, I just want to come to you very quickly, and because you've talked about the complexities of certain words, because we're winding up this discussion right now, I've always wanted to ask people who really understand language and gender, do most people know the difference between the sex and gender, and what's the difference there?
I think in the social sector, we assume that people know. Very recently, I had an experience of a gender training in a corporate sector, and I was shocked. I was shocked because I thought the educated young people today would know these terms and issues. Utter surprise, one of the very young, maybe urban educated person is asking me, but what benefit is gender training to the improving the company? And I said, thank you for asking that question, because that really opens up a way of talking about it. And I'm sort of afraid that except in these circles where we speak about it, there's very little information and knowledge. And actually, there is no space where this information and knowledge is shared, neither in our schools, nor in our books, nor in our social circles. So I think there is really no institutionalized ways in which this knowledge is shared, and that is really a huge, huge problem. And just adding on to, I think, in the workspace, in the home space, surely we need a gender partnership. Otherwise, I mean, we women are not wanting to sit at home and look after our babies. Surely we want to be working, we want to be looking after babies also. Not that we don't want to do that, but we don't want to be only doing that, like, you know. So I think, and even in the workspace, it's so important for a mutual respect and a mutual support to be there across gender and not make this only a kind of a negative relationship, sexism, sure. The kind of comments that come up. And I think it's too common in our sector.
Anshul, before we close this, because you work on a digital platform as well, and you've worked in as an editor, and someone, for example, me as an editor, I also think that the media plays a very large role in terms of making content and also making content cool enough for, you know, I mean, listen, it has to, people have to watch your content. Is it that difficult to make content that's that creates awareness about masculinity, gender awareness? Is it hard to do this stuff? Is it going to sell? Is it going to sell?
It sells. We get 20 million people reading that content every month.
Okay.
It sells because there is a severe lack of that information available, and people are looking for it. So if you create enough content, there will be users who will actually use it, who will actually go ahead with it. So
maybe there's got to be more dialogue within the
there
people
is,
and
absolutely.
How to package it.
Yes.
All right. I just want to thank my wonderful panelists. Happy Friday evening once again. We're just going to open up the floor for a couple of questions. I understand that one of our panelists has to leave. I myself am going to have to take your leave very soon. But please use this opportunity for a couple of questions if you have them. Just keep them very brief and just please quickly introduce yourself when you're asking them. And if you want to direct your question to somebody, you can. Otherwise, please ask it and I guess one of the panelists will take it. Please introduce yourself and just keep it very short.
Hi, I'm Sunanda. Do I need to stand up? I'll stand up. I'm Sunanda and I work with Change Alliance. And this is just a general question. As you see the conversation around gender equality growing, you're also seeing this pushback that a lot of women refuse to call themselves feminists. A lot of feminists are dismissed as feminazis. You also see the gender equality movement as something against a family, you know, the essential family values. So is this kind of a pushback something to worry about when you're talking about gender equality? Because there is this growing movement. I mean, it's both within, among men and women. So is this pushback something to worry about generally?
One second. You can answer, and both of you, both Miss Annie and I think you should answer that. Go ahead.
Okay. Actually, the thing is, the way we've seen it, because like I said, we develop a lot of content on this. See, there is a power dynamic in the society where men, because of their privilege, are more powerful. And the moment you question that power that has been constructed, the moment you try and throw somebody off that power, there will be backlash. So I think that backlash is expected and should happen. Only then will we actually have more dialogues around it. That's one. Second is, this construct also affects women. Patriarchy also affects women. I mean, it affects women in a big way. It also makes them think in a patriarchal manner. So I think that's also the reason why you see, you know, more women actually saying this, that, you know, I'm not a feminist, or I, you know, whatever, men's rights are also important, and so on. At the end of the day, it is actually a construct. It is something that is, the backlash is happening because you are actually trying to you know, dethrone somebody, you're trying to actually create equality. So I think we should accept it, this backlash, and we should take it head on. I think that's extremely important, that at least we have realized as a platform.
I think a lot of times the people who use these particular words come from whatever is running on popular media, but very few of them actually find out what the meaning of feminism is. And it just sounds like a really scary word because it's so difficult to understand, and it's something to do with women. So why should I be involved? So let's add feminazi to it, which just sounds really nice. But how many of them actually go on to basic Wikipedia just to check? Because you can't really be against feminism, because the fundamental idea is gender equality, which is connected to human rights. And if you're a human being, you couldn't be going against. It's basically wanting to be a Nazi itself. So it's just counteracts. I think there's lack of awareness about what the word actually means than on the particular word itself.
Yeah, I'm Satyendra. I work with Center for Social Equity and Inclusion. I want to put two things here right now. One is this, that is the gender education or gender-related values, it's only about mindset change, or it's a structural problem? Also, we need to address through structural change and structural discussions around it. For example, if we talk about that how women are put into different violence contexts and everything. The question is that how much are we really, the structure is really bother about putting gender budget or gender resource, gender kind of things around it, so that the men, women both can understand this, and at the school level or at the education level or higher education level or at any level. So what are the kind of a gender resource and budgeting has been put into that around it, so that the discussions and the structural things can be put into place, apart from what is going on is like mindset change and the thinking around that, okay, the value needs to be changed, which is more like personal and mindset level problem. The second thing is that also that how long we will not recognize the intersectional issues of violence being faced by women, Dalit women in the context. Like how, what happens when Dalit women and Dalit men, how the intersectional issues of patriarchy faced by this community, the contextualization, what is spoken earlier.
Sorry, I want you to summarize your question. What is your main question here? What are you trying to ask?
Yeah.
Just very quickly, because we have to keep it. I just want to, these have to be pointed questions.
Yeah, so what I'm is the talking main question? About the structural issues of addressing the masculinity or gender issues like gender budgeting,
sure,
and gender resource kind of things around it.
Okay.
That's the first aspect. The second aspect of intersectionality.
Sure. Miss Annie, would you like to go into that? Yeah.
No, I think both the dimensions are equally important, the mindset and the structural. Because just by changing the structural, we are not going to change the mindset. Just by trying to change the mindset, we'll not be impacting the structure. My simplest example is this Ola and Uber that has come in. Like, you know, it's become, they have sort of made the service end-to-end in such a manner that anybody is able to access it. And people are accessing it. So unless you sort of create the system, people are not going to be able to make that change. So I think both are extremely important, to have education, to have people to go through the process of revisioning a society through their mindset, and also setting in systems. Like, we know the government puts up so many provisions and programs, but nothing of them get implemented. And then we go back to say that, okay, these things don't change. So I think it's very important. And somewhere, I think, as you say, the intersectional issues have not really caught the attention necessary. Because if you really look at violence of a public nature, most of them are on the Dalit, the tribal, or the minority, caste, communal violences. And we have not really found adequate space for those discussions, adequate people to really create those demands and changes. So I think the intersectional issues really need to be much more closely looked at and addressed also.
I also want to add, in the corporate world, the stereotypes play a very big role. More than on the men, I've also seen on many occasions, my colleagues, the women, they have also accepted it. So I completely agree with her. It has to do with the mindset change at the root level. The way a woman, the perception of, she sees herself is a big issue. I can give you some live examples. Like certain managerial roles or certain roles, people won't come forward. I said, no, I mean, this is not for me. My simple question is, you know, how do you decide this is not for you? Because it has to do a lot with what they borrowed from around, you know, from the society, from the family, that certain things are not for them. But if you look at the skills, many of these people who are saying this is not for me, actually I found them far more skilled for that role than many men actually in the same team. So when I led teams in the past, I've had to sometimes even say, you know, you should, you know, decide that after giving it a try. And then the same, you know, I have two daughters, as I say, I told you. I have basically given them complete freedom the way I've raised them. And I can see that, you know, my second one has nothing, you know, very less feminine about her. I mean, not just the clothes she wears or whatever, the thinking. And she's just experimenting things. She's coming with ideas. She's only 15 years old. But some mind-blowing, you know, challenging ideas and concepts is coming from her. And she is a girl. That clearly proves that there is no, limits to what women can do. But women have accepted it. That's the whole problem. So mindset change has to, you know, also equally affect the women.
My name is Hayat. I am from UVA Youth for Unity and Voluntary Action. My question is that all you are in the NGO sector as well as corporate world, what we need the social conscious about what the word we are using, vocabulary we are using. Yeah. Like housewife, house ki koi wife nahi hoti. House husband, chairman, why not chairperson? Huh. So we need such kind of vocabulary improvement. In the report I read from the NGOs also, they use such words. So we should think about it.
That was one of the big points that was brought out, I think, by these organizations, that the language is a big problem also. And also things like be a man and, you know, things like that. So you're absolutely right. I think that's something that I hope there's enough activism around language that's taking place. It's a big thing, you know. But you're right.
Those who are working on the gender issues, they use such words.
They themselves use those words.
Yeah, they are ignorant about how to use them.
Okay. Good point. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're closing this session. Thank you for having been in a lovely audience. This is a great space, actually, this amphitheater, to have everyone around. I just want to thank my panelists and for the organization for having included me in this discussion. Thank you very, very much. And I hope you get a chance to reflect further on some of the issues that we've been discussing. Thank you.